against imperialist wars, racism, budget cuts, tuition hikes, police brutality, anti-LGBT bigotry, and in support of immigrant rights and women's rights. All along the way, I've been a consistent and tireless advocate for the rights of working people and for socialism. I and my comrade, Vice Presidential Candidate Jody Osorio, are running in this election to give voice to the struggles of working people in our communities and beyond. As Gloria said, right now the PSL is on the ballot in 6 states, and we already have our eye on at least 13 to 15. Our campaign is based around a 10-point program that speaks to the things that workers need. We want to make a job a constitutional right. We want to make free healthcare, free education, affordable housing constitutional rights. We want to shut down all U.S. military bases around the world and bring all the troops home. We want to stop police brutality and mass incarceration. We want to defend our unions. We want equality for women and free, safe, legal abortion on demand without apology. We want rights for all immigrants. We want full equality for lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender people. We want to save the environment. We want to save the planet by ending capitalism. And we want to seize the banks and jail Wall Street criminals. Around the world, people are rising up against a system that produces never-ending unemployment, low wages, poverty, violence, and brutality. In Egypt, in Tunisia, in Greece, Spain, Italy, and Quebec, the people have been taking to the streets to protest not just their conditions, but the brutal, oppressive system that created those conditions. And we think it's significant that so many of the leaders of this new movement are youth. For decades in the United States, anti-communism has been a deeply held, almost religious belief. One extremely important reason that this belief has been able to persist is that while most people can recognize the insanity and the depravity of a system of unchecked greed, for a long time the ruling class and the capitalists could always make the argument that while they are becoming ever richer and inequality between rich and poor was becoming ever greater, at least the lives of working families of working class people were manageable. In spite of the inequality, many working class people could say with some confidence to their children, it may be hard, but I know the system will allow you to have a better life than my generation and my parents' generation before us. That was the element that gave anti-capitalist, anti-communist propaganda some degree of traction. But it's our assessment that this phenomenon has turned into its opposite today. Capitalism today is not offering young people and young adults a better life than their parents, but can only promise a lifetime of increasing hardships, misery, poverty, and oppression. And this, we believe, shows and proves why capitalist, anti-communist, and anti-socialist propaganda will be overcome by a new mass socialist people's movement, a movement led by young people against capitalism. Let's look at the facts about the status of young people under capitalism today. Around the world, the crisis of youth unemployment has drawn many young people into the streets. Half the young workers in Greece and Spain don't have jobs. In the United States, youth unemployment, that's unemployment for those between the ages of 18 to 24, is the highest it's been since the government began recording those statistics. The gap in employment between the young and all working age adults is also the widest in recorded history. Unsurprisingly, the poverty rates for youth are extremely high as well. In Quebec, it's the skyrocketing tuitions that force the youth into the streets. In the United States, while median incomes for working people in this country have more or less stagnated over the past 20 years, tuition and fees have shot up 130%. The tuition for California state schools has risen more than 316% since 2002. All across the country, school budgets are being slashed, classes are being cut, enrollments being scaled down or shut down, and working class youth are finding that higher education, which is and should be a fundamental right, is becoming a privilege for the wealthy. But some working class youth persist. You know, I was working in a public high school class in downtown LA just a few months ago, and you wouldn't believe how hard these students are working. Statistically, despite the lack of funding, the inadequate resources, the attacks on teachers and their unions, more and more students are graduating and are considered college ready. This should be a good thing. We should be building more schools to accommodate those students. We should be making the universities more accessible for all students. But under capitalism, the opposite is happening. And the reality is that any working class student who wants a shot at college will at least have to take on tremendous amounts of debt in order to go. The aggregate student loan debt in the United States is at more than $1 trillion. $1 trillion in debt for people who just want to go to school. For many, the debt we've taken on becomes a life sentence. Last May, it was reported that the student loan debt for the graduating class of 2011 is the highest in history. It was also reported that a historically unprecedented 85% of those who graduated in 2011 will be forced to move back in with their parents, most likely due to a combination of high student loan debt, poverty, and unaffordable housing. I saw an article recently about a senior citizen whose social security check is being garnished to pay off the student loan debt she had accrued decades before. Young people are realizing that this is our future, a lifetime of a crippling debt for the privilege of getting education unless we stand up and fight back. And what about the wars, the persistent criminal imperialist wars? According to the Constitution, Congress has the right to declare war. Overlooking for a moment how often that law has been blatantly violated or otherwise circumvented in the last 20 years, let's look at the makeup of Congress. Right now, the average age of the members of the House of Representatives is around 57 years old. The average age of the Senate is around 62. And when the wars are fought, are people like our congressmen and women sent to do the fighting? No. The average age of men and women in the Army who actually have to go and kill or be killed is 21 years old. Those who call for these wars are nearly three times the age of the average soldier and are well protected by that fact from ever having to fight. What about the prison industrial complex? There are 2.3 million people in prison in the U.S. This means the U.S., with only 5% of the world's population, now has 25% of the world's prisoners. The largest age group that's being admitted to prisons is 20 to 25-year-olds, disproportionately Black and Latino youth. There are no jobs, schools out of our reach, but the prisons are opening up to welcome us with open arms. Right now, the state of California spends about $8,600 on higher education per student per year and about $50,000 per inmate. Look at the epidemic of police murder and police brutality. It is overwhelming when young people of color are being targeted by the police. A study was just released that showed that this past year, of the 110 African Americans that have been killed by the police, 59% were between the ages of 18 and 31. I was in Anaheim shortly after the police murdered 25-year-old Manuel Diaz and 21-year-old Joel Acevedo. And in Anaheim, just like in Spain, in Quebec, it was young people leading the fight back. I went to the city council meeting that Tuesday and stood with youth from the community. They're Black and brown teenagers and preteens who were losing their fear and facing down the police who had murdered their friends. I wrote a statement about it. You should check it out. It's on our table or online. But the most remarkable, striking thing about the demonstrations that day was that it reminded me of what I read of Soweto. It was an organized response by very young people who are fighting back against the racist oppression that has characterized their entire lives. So given that these are the major problems facing society today, unemployment, student loan debt, poverty, war, police brutality, mass incarceration, given that these are the major problems facing our society, our nation, and the world, and young people are indisputably disproportionately represented in each of these crises, why is it acceptable in this country to disenfranchise young people and routinely keep us from representing ourselves and the government that has the power to protect us? And running for president, I have received opposition from those who cling to the idea that the president must be at least 35. True, it's in the Constitution, but the Constitution has been changed. Not too long ago in this country, it would have been thought that being born a woman or an African American would have made me unfit to vote or participate in the democratic process at all. So I guess I'm lucky I got this far. The reality is, the only reason that people like me, women, and African Americans do have the right to vote is because of the victory of the mass movements. Marginalized, organized marches, rallies, sit-ins, hunger strikes, and protests. Civil rights and voting rights have to be fought for. And so we'll continue to build the mass movement to speak to young people who are fighting and those who have yet to join the struggle, and raise the banner of socialism in this next generation. All of these problems, the economy, the war, the prisons, these are problems that we inherited, but these are problems that we can fix. Socialism is the only answer. Revolution is our only option. Yay. For our future and for our lives. In California, as many of you know, the Secretary of State illegally and undemocratically removed me from the list of Peace and Freedom Party candidates in the June 5th primary. We are continuing the legal struggle to overturn the Secretary of State's undemocratic and unlawful exclusion of me from the ballot, and we appreciate the protests against its exclusion by the Peace and Freedom Party, yep. The Socialist Party, the Freedom Socialist Party, and the Justice Party. Either way, the PSL will be continuing to wage a dynamic campaign in the 15 states we expect to be on the ballot in 2012, including New York State, where right now our organizers are working hard gathering 30,000 signatures. We are highly aware of the threat posed to the continuing existence of the Peace and Freedom Party, the only openly socialist party with ballot status by the reactionary deceptive Prop 14. It is especially important that the party have as an energetic and visible a 2012 campaign as possible, one which can hopefully register tens of thousands of new PFP voters. If I were to win the nomination here today, but not win the court fight, that could could lead to the PFP presidential ballot line being blank. We do not want to see that happen. So I'm announcing that we are withdrawing from consideration for the Peace and Freedom Party's presidential and vice presidential nominations while continuing to run an active write-in campaign in California. I want to profoundly thank all the delegates who have supported my candidacy and urge them and all undecided and uncommitted delegates at the convention today to support the Roseanne Barr, Cindy Sheehan. Pledge to carry out a strong socialist campaign and work to build the PFP.